हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम अरविंद एंड ही इज मिस्टर सिंह एंड टुडे बोथ ऑफ अस विल ट्राई टू एक्सप्लेन अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक फ्रॉम चैप्टर नंबर 5 प्राइमरी एक्टिविटीज ऑफ बुक नंबर 1 फंडामेंटल्स ऑफ ह्यूमन ज्योग्राफी. वी विल डिस्कस द मीनिंग ऑफ प्राइमरी एक्टिविटीज, देन एग्जांपल्स ऑफ प्राइमरी एक्टिविटीज, what is hunting and gathering and why the area under hunting and gathering is shrinking, is becoming smaller. Next we will talk about pastoralism, the type of pastoralism, the difference between nomadic herding and commercial livestock rearing. So let's try to first understand the meaning of primary activities. Mr. Singh, you can take a rest, you can prepare for your topic. Okay students, so let's concentrate first on the meaning of primary activities. Primary activities means those activities which are related to natural environment, which has close relation with land, water, forest, wildlife, soil, etc. And the examples of primary activities are hunting and gathering, rearing of animals, that means animal husbandry, fishing, forestry, agriculture and farming, and mining and quarrying. These are called as primary activities. It is called primary activities because during ancient times, people first chose these activities for survival. That time, there were no other occupation before the people. So for survival, the first kind of occupation, the first kind of work people did was hunting and gathering. Then slowly they learn how to keep important animals with them so that they can be used as a source of food. Slowly they learn how to grow crops on the land, so agriculture was introduced, and also mining and quarrying. So please remember, primary activities means those activities which are directly related with natural environment. Agriculture, farming, animal husbandry, mining and quarrying, hunting and gathering, these are activities which are example of primary activities. Now I am inviting Mr. Singh to come and explain about hunting and gathering. Thank you, Arvind. Hunting and gathering is the oldest occupation of people on this earth. Since very ancient time, people were engaged in hunting and gathering. Thousands of years ago, there were no other occupation. The only thing that people can do was killing the animals and collecting some fruits, roots, nuts, flowers from the forest and use them as a food. So hunting and gathering, you must understand that this is the oldest occupation of people on this earth. Let's try to understand the meaning of hunting. What is hunting? Hunting means killing especially wild animals in the forest and using them as a source of food. Or their skin as a clothing. This is called as hunting. What is gathering? Gathering means collecting fruits, flower, stem, leaves, roots, gums, resin and other edible items which are available in the forest and using them as a food, and also they can sell these products in the market to earn some living. This is called as hunting and gathering. So I told you two important points, that hunting and gathering is the oldest occupation of people on this earth, and second, that hunting means killing of animals, gathering means collecting fruit, flower, leaves, root from the forest. During ancient times, thousands of years ago, all people on this earth depended on hunting and gathering. There were no other occupation that time on the earth. So the entire population was dependent on hunting and gathering. But in the present situation, at the present time, in the modern age, situation is different. Now, most of the people in this world are dependent on some other activity. Either they are raising some animals, they are doing farming, or they are working in factories. But very small size of population, especially the tribal people, only they are dependent on hunting and gathering. One important question comes in the CBSE examination, that why area under hunting and gathering is shrinking, that Mr. Arvind will explain you. Hunting and gathering is practiced mainly in a very extreme geographical condition, either very hot desert like Sahara Desert, or very high rainfall area like rainforest of Amazon Basin of South America, then the northern Canada, very cold area, northern Russia, again very cold area. So these extreme areas having either very hot or very cold temperature, very high rainfall or very low rainfall are the area where still some people, small size of population, are dependent on hunting and gathering. Hunting and gathering cannot support large size of population. Per capita productivity of hunting and gathering is very less. That means the income generating capacity of hunting and gathering is very low. It cannot support a large size of population. Today's world have millions, billions of population. That means hunting and gathering cannot support that big size of population. So now I'm inviting Mr. Singh to explain that why the area under hunting and gathering is shrinking. Thank you, Mr. Singh. Now I will tell you that why in most part of the country the area for hunting and gathering is becoming smaller. The area under hunting and gathering is shrinking. In other words, you can say that why the hunting and gathering activities have become less important. So first point you can write that hunting and gathering have been banned in most of the countries. Every country, every government is now banning killing of animals and cutting the trees. That means the movement inside the forest is highly controlled nowadays. Second point you can write that today, the government of many countries, they are classifying their natural forest as national parks, wildlife sanctuary and biosphere reserve. In this, the movement of people is highly restricted. That means a common man cannot go there and kill animals. There are many species of endangered animals. And killing those endangered animals is now punishable offense. That means if somebody kills those animals, they can be jailed, they can be put behind the bars. Hunting and gathering cannot support large size of population. It is a low income activity, and also the per capita productivity in hunting and gathering is very, very small. That means hunting and gathering can support to a small group of population, but cannot support a large size of population. During ancient times, people had no other option. They had only option to hunt the animal and take it as a food. But today, before the people have variety of other occupation like growing crops, even raising of animals, working in factory. Now hunting and gathering is less profitable, is not attractive for the people, and that's why people are not practicing hunting and gathering in many parts of the world. During ancient times, population was very small. The people could kill very few number of animals. But suppose today's population, which is more than 7 billion, if we all depend on hunting and gathering and start killing the animals, within no time we will destroy the entire environment. So hunting and gathering cannot be the option for the present generation of population. Those animals which could be eaten, now we have started them raising, called as animal husbandry. And those plants and fruits which can be eaten, now we have also started growing them on the land, called as agriculture. So hunting and gathering has gave birth to two important occupations, animal husbandry and agriculture. What is hunting? Hunting means killing of animals and using them as a source of food. Also using their skin as a clothing. Gathering means collecting fruits, leaves, stems, nuts, resins, gums, and using them also as a food, and also by selling them, people can earn small amount of living. So hunting means killing of animals, especially the wild animals, and gathering means collecting some useful products from the forest. Okay, so I will tell you about nomadic herding and he will tell you about commercial livestock rearing. So let me first complete my topic. Okay, please sit down. First try to understand the meaning of nomad. Nomad means the people who don't have a permanent place of living. That means they are not settled people. They keep on moving from one place to other place with their animals. They are called as nomadic herders. Means they don't have any fixed address. So their settlement is not permanent. This is the main definition of nomadic people. And if they are keeping some animals with them, they are called as nomadic herders. These nomadic herders keep some important animals which are suitable in a particular type of climate, in a particular type of geographical settings. For example, they can keep goat, sheep, camel, even yak and some other animals also in different parts of the country. Mostly, these kind of activities are practiced in extreme kind of climate, either very hot desert or very cold areas or even tropical rainforest. In such environmental setting, these herders keep important animals for food, skin, clothing, and also they sell the animal products in the market to earn small amount of living. As I told you that these people don't have any permanent settlement, any permanent place for living. They are moving with their animals. That means they don't have any permanent grazing land. So in search of grasses, they move from one place to other place. According to season, sometimes they move to the mountains during the summertime and they be there for 3-4 months with their animals. When winter sets in, that means when winter starts, they return back to the valley because on the mountain top, climate becomes very cold. Everywhere there are ice cover and there is no grass for the animal. So during the winter time, they return back to valley. So this seasonal movement of people with their animals from valley to mountain top in summer and from mountain top to the valley during the winter time is called as transhumans. Please remember the point, transhumans. What is transhumans? Transhumans means seasonal movement of nomadic herder along with their animals from valley to mountain top and from mountain top to valley, called as transhumans. The animals which nomadic herders keep are indigenous type, indigenous variety. That means the productivity is very, very low. These people sell the products in the local market and get some money and survive. The profit is very, very small. It can support a very small size of population. And mostly, it is done in those areas which are economically very, very backward. Therefore, we can say that nomadic herding occupation or activity is practiced in the backward or very less developed areas in the world. For example, the tropical Sahara Desert, the rainforest of Amazon Basin, the northern Canada, which is covered with the ice, and also the northern Russia, which is very, very cold. Now I am inviting Mr. Singh to explain commercial livestock rearing. So we are learning the difference between nomadic herding and commercial livestock rearing. About nomadic herding, Mr. Arvind has told you many points, and now I will explain you some important features of commercial livestock rearing. As the name suggests, it is a commercial activity. That means this is not done for survival. It is not a subsistence activity. It is done for the profit. It is done for earning money. So it is a commercial activity. If hunting and gathering is old method of keeping animals, then commercial livestock rearing is the new method of keeping animals. Second point you can write that commercial livestock rearing is practiced in highly advanced countries, those areas which are economically very developed areas. There are few important grasslands. They are called as temperate grasslands. These temperate grasslands are very important for commercial livestock rearing. You must learn the names as well as their location on the world map, that which are the areas where these temperate grasslands are found. These grasslands have commercial livestock rearing kind of activities. Number one is Pampas. Pampas is in Argentina, South America. Second is Prairies. Prairies is in North America. Then is Steppes in Russia, or you can say Central Russia. And the last one you can write about Downs. Downs is in Australia, Southeast Australia. So these are the four important temperate grasslands. One more is there also, that is called as Veld in South Africa, but that is very small area. You can remember only the four. So Pampas in South America, Prairies in North America, Steppes in Asia, and Downs in Australia. These are four important temperate grasslands where commercial livestock rearing is practiced. In commercial livestock rearing, hybrid and crossbreed, very advanced variety of animals are reared. That means indigenous varieties are not reared here. These hybrid have high productivity. They can provide more amount of milk, meat, skin, fur, and other animal products. In commercial livestock rearing, the products are not sold in the local market, but they are sold in the international market. As I told you that here the main objective is to earn profit. So they are using variety of machines. Their all activities are highly automated, right from feeding the animals, providing them medicine and vaccines, air conditioned area or safe for leaving the animals. Even some robots are used to provide food to the animals. Next important feature is that in commercial livestock rearing, people have their own permanent grazing land called as ranches. So these ranches are used as a grazing land. They have very large size of area that are covered with barbed wire, and they use one part of that area in 1 week, and then the next week they move their animal to the other part of that range and keep this part of the range so that the grass can grow again. So they are using the small part of the ranges on rotation basis, so that in one part the animals are grazing, but in the other part the grass is growing. So permanent grazing land called as ranches is another feature which you can write about commercial livestock rearing. One more point you can write that commercial livestock rearing is a very capital intensive activity. That means huge amount of investment is required in purchasing the machineries, refrigerators, then making safe, medication, providing food to the animals. We hope that you have enjoyed the class taken by me and Mr. Singh. So, see you next time with another video. Till then, take care of yourself. Thank you.